Waldo Jeffers had reached his limit. It was now mid-August. Jumenti had been separated from Marsha for more than 2 months. In 2 months, all he had to show were 3 dog-eared letters and 2 very expensive long-distance phone calls. True, when school had ended and she'd returned to Wisconsin due to Locust, Pennsylvania, she had sworn to maintain a certain fidelity. She would date occasionally, but merely as amusement. She would remain faithful. But lately, Waldo had begun to worry. He had trouble sleeping at nights. And when he did, he had horrible dreams. He lay awake at night, tossing and turning underneath his secretive protector, tears welling in his eyes as he pictured Marsha, her sworn vows of a kind like liquor and the smooth soothings of some Neanderthal, finally submitting to the final caresses of sexual union. It was more than human mind could bear. Visions of Marsha's faithlessness haunted him. Daytime fantasies of sexual abandon permeated his thoughts. And the thing was, they wouldn't understand how she really was. He, Waldo, alone understood this. He had intuitively grasped every nook and cranny of the psyche. He'd made her smile. She needed him, but he wasn't there. The idea came to him on the Thursday before the Mars parade was scheduled to appear. He just finished mowing and edging the other six lawn for $1.50, and I checked the mailbox to see if he was going to still work with Marsha. There was nothing but a circular from the Amalgamated Union Company of America inquiring into his own needs. At least they cared enough to write. There's a New York company. You could go anywhere in the mails. Then it struck him. He didn't have enough money to go to Wisconsin in the accepted fashion, true. Why not mail himself? It was absurd, you see. He would ship himself parcel post special delivery. The next day, Waldo went to the supermarket to purchase the necessary. He bought a plastic tape for staple gun and a medium-sized cardboard box just right for a person of his build. He judged that with a minimum of jostling, he could ride quite comfortably. A few air holes and water, and rusty-made snacks, and it would probably be as good as going tourist. By Friday afternoon, Waldo was sent. He was thoroughly packed, and the post office agreed to pick him up at 3 o'clock. He'd marked the package fragile, and as he sat curled up inside, resting on a foam rubber cushion in the trough of the mirror, he tried to picture the look of awe and happiness on Marsha's face as she opened the door, saw the package, tipped the deliverer, and then opened it to see her Waldo finally there in person. She would kiss him, and then maybe they could see a movie. If he'd only thought of this before. Suddenly, rough hands gripped his package, and he felt himself worn out. He landed with a thud in the truck, and was off. Marsha Bronson had just finished setting her hair. It had been a very rough weekend. She had to remember not to drink like that. Bill had been nice about it, though. After it was over, he said he still respected her, and after all, it was certainly the way of nature. And even though, no, he didn't love her, he did feel an affection for her. And after all, they were grown adults. Oh, and Bill could teach Barbara. But that seemed many years ago. Sheila Klein, her very, very best friend, walked in through the porch screen door and into the kitchen. Oh God, it's absolutely morbid outside. I know what you mean. I feel all the heat. Marsha tightened the belt on her cotton rope and silk underwear. Sheila ran her finger over some salt grains on the kitchen table, licked her finger and made a face. I'm supposed to be taking these salt pills, but she made the food. They make me feel like throwing up. Marsha started to pat herself in the gym, the exercise she'd seen on television. God, don't even talk about that. She got up from the table and went to the sink where she picked up a bottle of pink and blue vitamins. Walk one, supposed to be better than steak, and then attempted to touch her nose. I don't think I'll ever touch a daiquiri again. She gave up and sat down, this time near the small table that supported the telephone. Maybe Bill will call, she said to Sheila's glass. Sheila nibbled on the food. After last night, I thought maybe you'd be through with him. I know what you mean. My God, he's like an octopus, hands all over the place. She gestured, raising her arms upward in defense. The thing is, after a while, you get tired of fighting with him. And after all, I didn't really do anything Friday and Saturday, so I kind of hold it to him. You know what I mean? Just that he's scratched. She was keeping the handle of her mouth. I tell you, I felt the same way. And after a while, she came forward and whispered, I want to come back. Now she's laughing very loudly. It was at this this point that Mr. Jameson of the Clarence Darrow Post Office rang the doorbell of the large sticker coach from house. When Marsha Bronson opened the door, he had her carry package in. He had his yellow and his blue slips of paper signed and left the 15-cent tip that Marsha had got out of another small beige pocket from the den. "What do you think it is?" she asked. Marsha stood with her arms folded behind her back. She stared at the brown cardboard carton and suddenly, "I don't know." Inside the packet, Waldo quivered with excitement as he received the new voices. Sheila ran her fingernail over the mask of tape and ran by the center of the carpet. "Why don't you look at the return address and see where it's from?" Waldo felt his heart beating. He could feel the vibrating footsteps. Soon. Marsha walked around the carton and read the ink scratched label. "Oh, God, it's from Waldo!" "That schmuck," said Sheila. Waldo trembled with expectation. "Well, you might as well open it," said Sheila. Both of them tried to lift the staple flap. "He must have nailed it shut." They tugged in the flap again. "My God, you need a power drill to get this thing open." Again. "Can't get it open." They both stood still, breathing heavily. "Why don't you get a scissor?" said Sheila. Marsha ran to the kitchen, but all she could find was a good sewing scissor. Then she remembered that her father kept a collection of tools in the basement. She ran downstairs, and when she came back up, she had a large sheet metal cutter in hand. "This is the best I can find," "Here, you do it. I'm gonna die." She sank into a large fluffy couch and exhaled noisily. Sheila tried to make a slip of the deep masking tape and then she found the flap. The blade was too big, and there wasn't enough room. "God damn this thing," she said. Smiling. "I got an idea." "What?" said Marsha. "Just watch," said Sheila, touching her finger to her head. Inside the package, Waldo was so transfixed with excitement that he barely breathed. His skin fell quickly from the heat, and he could feel his heart beating his throat. It would be soon. Sheila stood quite upright and walked around to the other side of the package. Then she sank down to her knees, grasped the cutter by both handles, took a deep breath, and plunged the long blade through the middle of the package, through the masking tape, through the cardboard, through the cushioning, and right through the center of Waldo Jeffers' head, which split slightly and caused little rhythmic arcs of red to pulsate gently in the morning sun.